fox's nose kind of curves out a bit as well, so it's kind of like cute, sticks out a bit more.
Most of our men, they say when this woman's a little bit lighter, they are more beautiful, they're looking for it.
I inject a drug called melanotan, and it helps the process of darkening and without having to put on creams every night.
Hi, and welcome to Inside. I'm Jenny Brocky. Tonight, changing your face or changing your race.
I'm Heidi Liao. I'm 20 years old. Today, I'm getting my Asian rhinoplasty done.
What I don't like about my nose is that it's not very defined, it's quite flat, and then it bulges out. It looks like a mushroom. I want a more stronger look. I want a more defined tip, something that projects forward and makes me look focused and a strong look. In some sense, I am going after a Western look. People think big eyes and a higher bridge nose is a Western look, but I'm still going to look Asian. I kind of want to walk into a room and be like, hey everybody, look at me, look at my nose.
Oh yeah, that's what I wanted, like just to stick out on my face. What do you think of Megan Fox's nose? Do you know Megan Fox?
No.
You don't? She's from Transformers. You can Google her.
Although we make more proportional nose, but we don't want to make exactly like Western nose. Yeah. So whatever the nose which is suitable for your face. So the way I do the operation is I go into the nose, I harvest the cartilage. Then I release your soft tissue of the skin of the nose. And then I do the more extension, okay?
Okay, cool.
And then if there isn't enough cartilage, I might use your ear cartilage.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Heidi. How are you?
Good.
How's breathing? All that?
Yeah,
getting
good.
Better?
Yeah.
Swelling's gone? Much better?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. How much? Have a look. I will show you. Excited?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, looking good?
Yeah.
Yeah, it'll keep getting better day by day, okay? But this is only fifth day. So I make a teeth definition and bridge.
It feels so strange touching it.
Yeah, it's a bit numb at the moment.
Yeah.
Heidi, that was 3 weeks ago. Are you happy with your
I
new nose?
I love it.
Why do you love it?
The bridge is higher. And I have that kind of like flick in there. And I noticed that they put in the Megan Fox bit. I like how Megan Fox's nose kind of curves out a bit as well. So it's kind of like cute, sticks out a bit more.
Now, the same day your nose cast came off,
yeah.
You had another operation. What else did you have done?
I had my chin done. So before my chin was a bit short. It was a bit receded, so I went ahead and got a chin implant, just a small one, just to bring my chin forward to come in balance with my nose. Mm. Just like one third, one third, one third.
You kept a video diary of what happened after the surgery. Now, that's on our website, but let's have just a peek at some of that.
I just got my nose done yesterday. I can't eat too much because I feel a bit sick. I changed the packaging before, because I was soaked with blood. When I woke up the operation, I was like, oh my gosh, what's happening? Please reverse this, please reverse this.
I'm feeling a whole lot better and really excited to see the results.
It gives me much better balance with my nose. And I think I look great. Minus the bruising.
Was it worth it?
In what sense? Like looking different or
all
the
that pain, all that surgery, was it worth it for how you look now? From your perspective, was it worth going through all that pain?
I think so, yes. But I was procrastinating about my chin because It was different. Like, I had a more innocent, childlike face, cutesy kind of face, and my chin changed the face of my, the shape of my face. It was more, it's more oval now. And I was procrastinating more about my chin than my nose, but thinking back now, that all the swelling and all the healing, I think that it was worth it. I mean, it wasn't worth stressing about it, though.
So before the nose and the chin, you had eyelid surgery as well. So you've had three operations altogether. And let's have a look at what you look like before, before all the surgery, and this is what you look like now.
Yeah.
And do you think there's a big difference?
Massive difference.
Yeah? Everyone, people nodding? Yes? No? Yes? Big difference. Everybody thinks a big difference. You said you wanted a more Western look, Heidi. Why?
I do like Caucasian features. They do have bigger eyes, taller noses, project more strong features. Whereas Asians, in my opinion, I feel that their face is a bit more rounded off, modelled up. And I mean, I did grow up in like a school where there was like a lot of white people, and you know, when you're younger, you want it to be just like them as well.
And did that influence you, do you think, to do all this?
Well, what influenced me with my eyes was when I was in year four, I moved to a different school, and there was this girl, and she was a really, really good dancer, and everyone loved her, and I had to sit next to her, and I looked at her eyes for the first time. I was like, wow, I want her eyes. And she had these massive big eyes and lashes and everything, and I think that kind of started my, you know, feeling more self-conscious about my eyes and realising, oh crap, I don't look exactly like everybody.
So do you think it's because you live in Australia that you feel like that?
Maybe, but I mean, I also wanted to look like a manga character, like in all those Japanese cartoons, like Sailor Moon and all that. And I don't know, I guess so, but I don't think living in Australia exactly influenced me to want to look more westernised.
More Western, but you do want to look more Western.
Yeah. I mean, you could see from my way of dressing and way I talk, I guess.
Andrew Kim, you operated on Heidi. You've been running your clinic for around 10 years.
Definitely.
And you're mainly dealing with patients from an Asian background.
Definitely.
What do most of them want and why when they come to you?
They normally come with just simple request. Just, I want to look more beautiful. Okay, this quite subjective terminology. As a surgeon, I got a bit of guideline. So the guideline for me is the golden rule of division, which is ideal image of the face is divided in vertically. So we divide into five portions. The ideal image of ideal image of face is divided horizontally. We divide into three segments. So when I do the operation, I reflect this into the operation.
And is that ideal face a Western face or is it an Asian face?
Yeah,
and when I say Asian, I mean, that can cover a huge range of different characteristics. But what is that ideal face?
Yeah, golden rule of division is not really designed for Asian face or Caucasian. It's just universal. So it's more Western face is a lot more well proportioned according to the golden rule of division. So when Heidi comes along asking me for the cosmetic surgery, she wants to have bigger eyes. I do understand. I normally measure the eye length, longitudinal length. Usually Asians are shorter than Caucasians. So I try to make more proportioned face, proportioned eyes, proportioned nose.
But that means a more Western look?
See, I don't think it's the Western look, it's more balanced look. It's more Caucasians are a lot more balanced than Asians in terms of this golden rule of division.
And your patients, when they come to you and they ask for this surgery, how many of them are saying they want to actually change their racial features, that they don't want to look as Asian?
Not really. I mean, they don't really ask for the changing racial features. They just want, as I told you before, you know, they want to get just simply, I want to look more beautiful.
Is it ever about being bullied at school or having being given a difficult
pretty
time?
Pretty rare, but I hear these not uncommon. Once in a while, I hear these stories, especially younger age groups. say, very early teenagers. Say, Heidi, say, experience when you are, so year four. So around that age group, to about early teenagers, you know, they might get a little bit bullied at schoolyard because of their look, the bit teased on their looks. But this is just minority request.
So you have children coming for surgery?
Yes, they come for the surgery.
What sort of surgery?
Eyelid surgery.
And is that parental pressure that's bringing that? How young are those children?
I operate as young as 12 years old.
12?
Yeah, that was the youngest I ever operated.
And for, this is for the just eyes. For cosmetic for eyes? It's purely cosmetic?
Yeah, that's purely cosmetic. Just want to look a little bit bigger.
What do people think about this? And how widespread is it? Yeah.
I'm shocked because at 12 years old, that's when kids are starting to develop, and that's their self-esteem. Mm-hmm. And you're encouraging the self-esteem to come to you're encouraging them to have low self-esteem by giving them the surgery that they want, and they could change their mind in a week or two. You know, and this is something permanent that you're doing. How can you feel good about yourself doing that?
I'm not, it's not really self-esteem in terms of, see, once they get bullying, they want to get a little bit bigger eyes.
Andrew, you've had surgery yourself. Why did you have surgery yourself? What did you have done?
Yeah, I came to Australia when I was 16 years old. I found I look very different. That was pretty much 27 years back. So I tried to assimilate. Even that time, I was thought about, what's the answer for that? I thought, I might do cosmetic surgery on myself. I mean, not myself, but I tried to do.
Glad you didn't do that.
I tried to see a cosmetic surgeon. But of course, my parents are horrified and, you know, they hear nothing of it. They say absolutely not. So
you had your eyelids
done
as well?
I done eyelid and hair transplant and my nose is done.
Okay. And did it make you feel different about yourself?
No, I'm not really different, but I think I look a lot more balanced look. I look more proportioned look.
Yeah, we've got a photo of you before and you do look quite different now to the way you looked before. Yes, quite different. Angelo, I know that you're a plastic surgeon and you specialise in facial surgery. You're dealing with patients from various ethnic backgrounds. What are you seeing? What are people wanting?
Well, a lot of the... Just to go back to a point that Andrew made, I think when we're dealing with eyelid surgery in Asian patients as children, it's not fundamentally that different to younger Caucasian children that come to have their ears pinned back. Many children would come at 10, 11, 12, 13 years of age, and yet people naturally would suggest that that's perhaps a more reasonable surgery than operating on an Asian child's eyes, and yet fundamentally, there's not a large amount of difference, and yet a lot of children do get teased quite a lot about having very large ears, and the surgery to fix that is, I guess, strictly cosmetic surgery, and lots of children have that. But on another point, I think, you know, Asian eyelid surgery certainly is very common, as is rhinoplasty in a lot of Middle Eastern patients.
Rhinoplasty, for those who don't know, is nose operations,
And certainly that's more common in certain ethnic groups than others. And
so which ethnic groups is it more common in?
Well, certainly I think patients from around the Mediterranean and in that sort of belt of the Middle East, it's quite common, such that many of the newer nose job or rhinoplasty techniques are coming from Turkey, which interestingly enough is a bridge between the East and the West. Traditionally, even through historic times, Constantinople, Istanbul has been a meeting of the East and the West, and there's certainly perhaps a homogenization of what the ideal nose is said to look like. And that may go back to Andrew's rule of proportions. But one of my theories is that if you were to take a magazine cover from Japanese Vogue, Italian Vogue, vogue in Egypt, there's a great degree of similarity in the facial proportions if you were to remove the racial and ethnic pigmentation and features.
Okay, so that universal idea of beauty. Meredith, you wanted to say something.
It's about the comparing the children with the ears and the eyes is a really, really important one, because I think what we risk in this sort of debate and this sort of discussion is a kind of reverse racism, where it's all right for so-called white people to have certain kinds of cosmetic procedures or body modifications, but it's not all right for Asians or Indians or Turkish people or other Mediterranean people to have certain other kinds of cosmetic procedures. So I think we only have to look at Heidi, and Heidi probably agrees, she still looks Asian. She looks different.
Alan, you're Heidi's father. What did you think about what she did?
Well, it's a shock to me initially when she's first come home, and you can see on the screen which is all bruising and all that. I'm as father, we always worry about our children, make sure they are safe. And when she come home in this sort of state, it really shocks me. But I'm glad at this point in time things seems to have subsided and she seems to have recovered reasonably well. And
did you recognize her? In the sense of, that's an interesting situation as a father to see your child changed like that. What was that like?
It was done in stages. Initially, in the eye stage, she sort of forewarned us, so we kind of prepared ourselves. But when she did her nose and the jaw and came back, I just thought, who is this girl in my house? Absolutely shocked. But I'm glad that it turned out and she sort of recovered reasonably well, and I hope that there will be less of it and she get better from now on.
Mm. Double eyelid surgery was the first surgery she had, and we've been talking about that quite a bit. I'd like to just fill people in watching this on what exactly it is. And Andrew, you've performed hundreds of these operations. Can you talk us through what we're seeing here? Because this is an actual section of an operation. Mm-hmm. That you're doing.
Yeah, this is just the initial stage of the operation, and I'm making skin incision to get rid of a bit of loose skin. I just measure the loose skin I'm removing, and I also remove soft tissues as well to try to create the double fold more clearly and more easily. So I'm just
so
making double
fold. So this is creating a crease in the eyelid.
That's right. I'm creating crease at the moment, and I finished operation with the just cutaneous sutures. So this has been done under local.
Ow.
Mainly. So it's not painful as it
no,
looks.
No, I'm sure it's not painful. It's just painful to watch. Glenda, that's you under the knife there. What's it like watching the operation, and
it's
why did you decide to have
this?
It's my
surgery? First time watching it, so it's quite shocking to me as well. I didn't think it was that bloody. But I didn't feel a thing while going through the surgery.
Why did you do it?
It wasn't necessary to try to look Western. For me, it was just to enhance my eyes. I like the shape of my eyes. The doctor didn't need to lengthen it. He just needed to create the fold.
Why did you want the fold?
I think it's prettier with the crease in the eyes. It makes it enhances it. Before I came to do the surgery, my eyes were a little bit droopy. It looked a bit tired. And now, I think it looks more youthful. Like
another point I'd like to mention, the operation that Glenda gone through, and then the operation I'm doing on 12 years old is quite different. It's not as invasive as this. Mm-hmm. You say it's irreversible. It is quite reversible. So I do just minor procedure, in a way. It's very, very, it's quite shocking when I say 12 years old, everyone get freaked out.
Yeah. Yeah.
Glenda wants to say something. Yeah.
I'm not trying to look Western. There are many Asians out there with double fold eyelids. For example, my boyfriend, he's got quite a large crease. My friends, they all have got large creases as well. My crease was quite small. I just wanted to make it look more defined. Yeah, it's not about trying to look Western or anything like that. I think it just helps to improve my eyes to make it look better. Mm. Originally, when I came to the doctor, I brought a photo with me, and it was of a Korean actress. It wasn't of a Western celebrity. It was of a Korean actress. So I showed it to him, and I said to him, this is what I want to look like.
All right, Rian, what are you listening to all of this? You're looking very worried. You've got a big frown on your face. What's wrong with people wanting to change the way they look?
I think it's all about fitting in. So I think it's some of my work, I talked to young women from Middle Eastern backgrounds who'd had their noses done, and many of them said they were teased at school. Now, the impact of that teasing had stayed with them, and they had saved and saved so that they could get their noses done. And there was an issue, there was a tension there, because they said, on the one hand, I wanted it done because I didn't want to have my father's nose, but on the other hand, I'm denying my heritage. And that was the tension that they felt. But they felt so strongly, particularly having been teased at school, that they wanted to get it done, that was almost an obsession with them.
Mm. Heidi, does any of that ring true for you about any teasing at school being an influence in getting the work done? Or Glenda?
When you're not young.
What about you, Heidi?
Only when you're young and people judge you and you're the new kid, because I moved schools closer to home. And, I was me and one other girl. We were, like, the only Asian girl. So they'll be like, oh, the new Asian girl. Why do you have to call me the new Asian girl? Why can't you call me Heidi, you know? No, because she's Asian. And that makes you stand out from everybody. But I've researched all my procedures since I was like 15, 16. And I finally picked up the guts last year when I was 20 to go see Dr. Kim. And I did research that extensively. And yes, I am still Asian and I am proud to be Asian. I live, you know, in a Western society, but you guys aren't Asian. Some of you aren't Asian and you haven't been through what I've been through, going to a new school or meeting people and they're like, oh, she's Asian. Oh, she might be like in those cartoons, Ching Chong Wah, and say all that kind of stuff. And they judge you based on what you look. And little kids are like that. We're all visual creatures. We look at each other and we'll think, oh, she's Asian, she might not speak English properly. Or she's Asian, she's a nerd. Or, oh, she's Asian, she can't read English properly. You're not like that. You're judging me before you meet me.
We're going to leave that there for the moment. When we come back after the break, coming up, other ways of changing what you're born with.
मर्दों की त्वचा होती है सख्त, जिस पे लड़कियों वाली फेयरनेस क्रीम बेअसर। सिर्फ इमामी फेयर एंड हैंडसम में है अमेरिकन लूमिनो पेप्टाइड, जो किसी भी साधारण मर्दों वाली फेयरनेस क्रीम से ज्यादा असरदार, ज्यादा फास्ट।
इमामी फेयर एंड हैंडसम, दुनिया की नंबर वन फेयरनेस क्रीम मर्दों के लिए।
Tonight we're talking about beauty and race. Check out this ad from India.
मधुबाला की कहानी रोल मेरा ही होगा
लगता है मुझे अपनी मधुबाला मिल गई ब्यूटीफुल आईज ग्रेट स्माइल फिर भी कुछ कमी है नेक्स्ट
फिर भी कुछ कमी है क्योंकि कमी तुम्हारी इस नेचुरल क्रीम में है
सिर्फ फेयर एंड लवली आयुर्वेदिक बैलेंस में है 16 आयुर्वेदिक तत्व जो दें कुदरती निखार
मधुबाला भी आज खुश होती
नई फेयर एंड लवली आयुर्वेदिक बैलेंस
Fair and lovely. Yassine, you're originally from Senegal and you use skin bleaching products. Why?
Yeah, I've been using it for like quite more than 5 years. I'm just using it because I see some of my friends and like my mom used to use it before. Yeah, like for us, most of our men, they say when this woman a little bit lighter, they are more beautiful, they're looking for it. And some of our men use it, but me, I use it because I see some of my friends who use it and they are really beautiful. And I'm looking myself, I'm getting much better and I like it.
So lighter skin is more beautiful to
yeah,
you?
For me.
Yeah, and how much of it is about men finding lighter skinned women attractive? Well, you thinking that men find lighter skinned women attractive?
Yeah, they do. They do find out like women who's more lighter are more beautiful and they... And most of our men's, like from my country, they're looking for a lighter woman and stuff like that. And yeah, I don't see any different. I see a little bit different, but I just like it.
Kema, you're a model from an Indian background. You grew up here, but you come from an Indian background. Have you ever felt pressure to use those sort of products?
I did when I was younger. It's pretty much ingrained in the Indian culture that the lighter skinned you are, the more beautiful you are. And I used to find when I would go outside and be outdoors with my friends and get darker, when I came back home, my parents would go, "Oh, you've been out in the sun. Like, don't spend so much time out in the sun." And so I did try the products, but I didn't like them because I found that they made my skin really dry. And as I got older, I just kept thinking, why should I be trying to change my skin colour? It's natural. It's me going out in the sun and getting a tan like everybody else. And the older I got, I did more research on it and I found that there were actually quite harmful ingredients in some of these products. So that just turned me off them completely.
Yassine, what do you think about men using these products?
I don't like it when men using it.
Why?
Because some of the men, they use it and they don't know how to use it.
They don't know how to use it?
Yeah.
So what happens?
They look like, they look different. Because some of their bodies, some of the parts are dark.
Because they're patchy. They don't use it properly. But you don't like men using it?
I don't like it.
There is a market for men though, endorsed by Bollywood star Shahrukh Khan. Have a look at this.
ओ पहलवान लड़कियों वाली फेयरनेस क्रीम लगा रहा है कल नेल पॉलिश लगाएगा परसों लिपस्टिक हां लंगोट उतार लहंगा लपेट ले
पहलवान फेयर एंड हैंडसम लगा मर्दों की त्वचा होती है सख्त जिस पे लड़कियों वाली फेयरनेस क्रीम बेअसर सिर्फ इमामी फेयर एंड हैंडसम में है अमेरिकन लुमिनोपेप्टाइड जो किसी भी साधारण मर्दों वाली फेयरनेस क्रीम से ज्यादा असरदार ज्यादा फास्ट
Imami Fair and Handsome, duniya ki number one fairness cream, mardon ke liye.
What do some of the men here think of this? Peter, what do you think of skin whitening?
Personally, I don't find it fancy. I don't think it's something one should do. Personally, I'm very proud of my skin. I believe in whatever skin you've been born with, you should be proud of it and retain it. I've always preached to my children that being black is something you should be proud of. And
but you're attracted to blondes, I hear.
Yes.
Is this and, right?
I love women with blonde hair. And
what looking, I find attractive... Yassine's looking like you've just made the case for her, I think. Yes.
What I find attractive in women is not necessarily their facial look, it's the hair they put on. If you have a blonde hair or you can dye your hair whatever color, but not your skin, so to me, I rather prefer to retain my skin rather than changing my hairstyle.
Adrian Lim is a dermatologist. I just wonder whether he might think there's something different between dyeing your hair and dyeing your skin. Adrian?
To lighten the skin is virtually impossible. You know, you're born with a constitutional color. You know, you might move a shade down by not exposing yourself to the sun, but to actually move several shades is very difficult. So I think, you know, what one of the things that concerned me about a commercial for the Indian market is that it is really just hype. And, you know, it's equivalent to the anti-aging cream that developed countries have. We know they don't work, but, you know, we have disposable income to actually buy them. But in the poorer countries, I think there is an ethical issue about promoting fairness. I think from an economic point of view, to be marketing something that does not work, is really unethical.
And what about safety?
Well, there is some question regarding the safety of one of the most used ingredients called hydroquinone. Hydroquinone is very controversial. It was banned in Europe in 2001 on the basis that it can cause cancers. Now, having said that, the cancers are found in laboratory animals, rats. So rats are not humans, and we do have safety record in humans over 56 years demonstrating safety. However, based on that, the US and Australia has not outrightly banned hydroquinone. We maintain the right to prescribe hydroquinone at concentrations of 4%. And I do know that in certain African countries where there is intense pressure to lighten the skin, regular use of hydroquinone of 10%, sometimes 20% over many years can result in a condition called ochronosis, which is a really unfortunate, irreversible, paradoxical darkening of the skin.
Yasin, your reaction?
Yeah, I just want to say something. Like before, I'm proud to be black and I'm still black. You can see from my skin, I'm a little bit lighter because I was not born like that, but I'm still black, you can see it. But I'm just like to use the cream because it depends. For me, I'm thinking maybe you will have some cause, but it depends how you use it because I'm using just the cream, nothing just very strong, like some people just mixing a lot of things to using it.
Brian, you have fair skin. Do you like it?
No.
So what do you do about it?
I inject a drug called melanotan. It's an injection just like you would if you had diabetes, so insulin syringe. You inject into the fat of your stomach. It stimulates the melanin in your skin and you sort of begin to start tanning, and then you can go into the sun for 15 minutes a week and it helps the process of darkening, and without having to put on creams every night. You can have...
A week, you said? A week. Only a week.
You don't need... No, you don't need a lot of sun to help it go.
How's your vitamin D levels?
Your vitamin D.
Oh, no, I just mean, like, direct sunlight, like baking in the sun.
Yeah. You're supposed to get vitamin D. It's a naturally occurring thing.
I think so.
And why is that so important to you, Brian?
It fits in with my lifestyle, going to the beach all the time. It helps to have that that complexion, and it makes me feel more comfortable with my body.
So is there a difference between skin whitening and tanning?
Ethical issues. I'm just wondering, like the people who want their skin lightened and things like that, you bring up the ethical issues and how the media's portrayed things and what's more attractive, and is that moral to advertise in poorer countries? I'd like to ask the surgeons over here, you know, do you send patients who come in and say, look, I want my eyes lengthened, I want this, I want that, do you send them to talk to a psychologist or a psychotherapist or something to find out, is there something in their head that may need to be changed before you actually change their physical appearance and before you give them something that might be potentially dangerous?
Mm. Could I have a response from you two about that? Psychological testing?
Yeah, look, I think the short answer is generally not. I think... most of the patients that you do see, you speak to and you get an impression by speaking to them and their motivations and their requests. There is a minority of patients, I would say probably less than 5%, that I would see that where I would have a concern.
You write a script and they'll take your advice. If you say to them, you can't have the surgery unless you get cleared by your psychologist...
It's pretty you offend the patient's feelings.
Yeah. Can Andrew just respond to that?
I think you can offend the patient as well.
You're not calling them crazy. Yeah. You just want to ask them what the issue is.
Yeah, that's right. Even you saying... So you got to be very careful when you saying these things.
So you may offend them and then they may not get the surgery done. But surely the most important thing is they're totally objective.
Yeah, but it's very, very difficult to get that idea get across to the patient, I think.
I want to get back to something that Brian raised about injecting this melanotan into your skin. And Adrian, I just wanted to ask you about the safety of that.
Yes, can I just ask Brian where he got the melanotan from? Because as far as I'm concerned, the melanotan is currently restricted to trials. And the internet purchase is almost certainly a counterfeit.
Yeah, I get it from the internet. It's from Australia, though. The stockist is in Australia. And they are from a company in Europe. And they do have a license to bring it in, so they had to fill out all their paperwork so that they're not putting in additives and stuff that we don't know what we're putting into our body. So it is what's stated on the internet, like we do know what's in it.
Adrian, safety, just what is
I think that the melanotan is a pituitary hormone. It's a melanocyte-stimulating hormone, and it shares homology or similarity to a few other brain hormones that controls the gonads, the ovaries, testicles, adrenals. So,
how are you feeling over there, Brian?
Some pretty serious side effects when you're in your speedos.
Okay, can we just? I just want to hear the rest of this.
leaving that aside, that there are concerns about impurities and contamination with bacteria. So being an individual ordering this sort of drug that's not approved is taking a risk. I know it is, you can get it in. I know it's not illegal to administer it to yourself. Yeah. But, you know, you are taking an unnecessary risk because we don't have the data. It's still being trialed and we don't know the long-term consequences. And the area of trial basically is for, men and women who are allergic to sunlight.
Brian, your reaction to that?
No, definitely, I understand that, and that's definitely on where you can read all that on the internet. So I understand that, but I've taken it upon myself to take that risk.
And why is it so important to you?
It's affected my life quite largely. I mean, I'm really pale, so I've kept out of the sun because I burn really easily. And that means I can't go to the beach with my mates. You know, I can't do these things that I really want to do. And a beach is a part of my life, a big part of my life. And so this has allowed me to be able to do that and be more comfortable in my skin and go out with my friends and do what I wanted to do. And so that's changed my life.
Kama, your experience, have you ever found, as a model, have you ever found it more difficult to get work, for example, because of your skin, the colour of your skin or your looks? Are you discriminated against because of it? Is that part of the reason? Is that what drives skin whitening? Or is it just cosmetic too?
I think it's all of the above. I spent 2 years in London working in media and modelling on the side, and I found while I was getting work in mainstream print work and mainstream beauty work, when I went to the Indian markets over there, they would advertise for Indian girls with European features. And so I was limited there. I was an Indian girl, but I didn't have fair skin, I didn't have light eyes. So I stuck to the mainstream market that embraced all kinds of looks. And when I came home to Perth, I decided I wanted to continue on with the modelling, and I applied to a few different agencies. And one of them responded back to me saying, due to my non-Caucasian heritage, my work opportunities were going to be extremely limited. So in that sense, yes, I think looking the way I do has its limits in this country.
Mm, and Brian, having fair skin wouldn't have limited your work opportunities.
No,
I wouldn't have thought.
No.
Yes,
no.
Okay. Well, coming up, what we find attractive and why. That's next on Insight. Tonight we're talking about beauty, racial features and cosmetic changes. Meredith, what do we regard as beautiful now?
Gee, that's a hard one. It's actually changing day by day. We've got such a fast-moving media environment that we are almost constantly demanding a new standard of beauty. Two big trends at the moment. One is for a kind of hybrid beauty. You might call someone like Halle Berry, the Australian model Samantha Murray. They've both got this sort of very fashionable hybrid beauty at the moment. And the other kind of beauty that's really fashionable is a kind of little girl face, a little doll face, where you've got a much smaller lower half of the face than the top of the face, great big eyes.
And is this universal? When you say we, are you talking about your Caucasian community, or are you talking about a broader international notion of beauty?
I'd say it's pretty much universal in what we might call the overdeveloped world or the post-industrial world. Of course, there are many parts of the world that don't have the kind of media saturation that we do have. But, you know, basically Canada, Australia, the US, the UK are pretty much all part of these very broad trends.
All right, I want you to all have a look at these pictures. Have a look at these. These are composite faces of attractive women sorted by race. So they've taken a whole lot of attractive women from each racial group. They were created by a Korean doctor who specialises in plastic and reconstructive surgery at a teaching hospital in Korea. Now, he's chosen a number of celebrities from each group who are generally regarded as attractive, and he's morphed their faces into one. So he's divided all the African celebrities and people who are regarded as attractive, all the Caucasians, the Chinese, the Japanese and the Koreans, morphed those faces into one face which represents an average of each racial group. And that's what he found is beautiful. Now, what do people think of that? That's the average beauty out of each group.
I'm looking at them and they all have the same nose, the same lips, the same eyes and the same eyebrows. It just looks like everyone should look the same. And that's not beauty. Beauty is being unique.
Okay, Angelo, this was the point that you were making.
Yeah, I have a theory that I think what you say is correct, and that there is, because of the saturation of the media and I guess more recently in the last 10 years or so, the internet, that there is a homogenization and a centralization of what the greater populace considers attractive. And it's interesting to see that, if you were to take the color variations out of those faces, I agree, they're remarkably similar.
So what does that tell us about what we regard as beautiful?
Well, it tells us that it's boring.
But it's very consistent. It's quite consistent.
It also tells you it's a product. Beauty is what you don't have. So if you've got dark hair, they'll tell you it's blonde hair that looks beautiful. If you're dark, they'll tell you it's white that looks beautiful. Mm-hmm. If your eyes are blue, they'll say contact lenses. Mm. Like there's a product for everything.
Do you all find those faces attractive?
No.
And don't say no just for the sake of it. I want to get a sense of whether people find them attractive.
But they're not the people we're marrying, are they? Let's face it.
They're not the people we're marrying. Okay.
So, we have to find somebody who maybe doesn't conform with that kind of global...
But is that the notion
I'm happy to say that I've never had, plastic surgery, but I think you can know that already.
Okay, so. is that the notion of beauty that people aspire to? I mean, Heidi, when you look at those pictures, is that kind of the look that you're aspiring to?
Yeah, that fresh-faced, innocent, wide-eyed.
Honey, why do you want to look like everyone else?
Actually, I don't.
Good question.
I've taken bits of like what I want and made it into what I think will suit me.
So
I'm enhancing what I look like.
I feel like you're trying to fit into something, to want to look like someone else, or you look at someone else's eyes and go, gee, I want those eyes. What about your eyes? What about your face? What about your beauty that makes you you? That's what when I saw your face before the surgery, I was like, wow, she's gorgeous. And then when I looked at your face now, I'm like, oh yeah, it kind of reminds me of that actress who's had her stuff done.
When I look at the Heidi, she was a very beautiful girl to me.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
But she come up with sort of preconceived ideas.
But that's only her.
Yeah, let him finish. I'm interested in what he has to say. Go on, Andrew.
And she come up with a bit more objective request. She wants to get higher nasal bridge. She wants to get tip definition. These are the things we can achieve with cosmetic surgery.
Yeah.
I'm not making her more beautiful. Okay. I don't think cosmetic surgery is making more beautiful. I make person more balanced look, more proportioned face.
If whatever
who's happy with that, I think that's very good. Do you know what I mean?
Heidi, what if she could be happy
without the surgery? What if she could actually talk to someone and feel accepted by someone? What if she changed her group of friends that were picking on her? And what if she could be made happy without having to go into the night?
What about we let Heidi talk for herself, Heidi?
Is your inner beauty. Like, people tell me they love me because of I'm bubbly, I'm out there, I'm funny, I'm cheeky. Okay. If I had a twin sister and she was boring and she was dull and she was negative, who are they going to love more, me or her? Me, obviously. But it's more of your personality that people fall in love with. It's not, like they said, your smile or your eyes, it's your soul shining through.
Glenda, is that a kind of idealised view of beauty that you would have?
They're beautiful faces, but I wasn't trying to, I was happy with my look. I just wanted to enhance my eyes. That was it.
I think it's important that we put the individual first in all these considerations. I mean, these are young, independent women and men making decisions. Now, certainly I can speak to them and I can guide them and suggest things that are possible and things that are not possible, but is it really my role to say, Well, look, I think you're attractive enough, and this really goes back to some Freudian thing that happened when you were five. And right next door to me, there's a psychiatrist. Perhaps you should chat to them.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not right. anybody else's role. That's These right. are sort of independent individuals who've thought about their decision. Part of my job as a surgeon is to find the people who don't fit that mould, and they're in by far the minority.
So your job is to seek out people who are unhappy and then operate on them to make them feel happy?
Not at all. My job is to speak to people, make sure that they're making a decision and that their request is reasonable and achievable. It's not to say to them or belittle them and say, you really should be happy with yourself and you do have an inner light and it is shining out.
I'd like to hear from Rian here.
I think there's two issues here. One is that from my research, women do this for themselves. They do it because there's something inside them that wants this to happen, and who are we to judge? But the second thing is, you look at all those pictures there that have been put together like a photo fit by a surgeon. Guess what's going to happen? That is the face you're going to get if you're going to go to that surgeon. I spoke to a very experienced surgeon in my research, and he said to me, don't believe any of this business that you can get the nose that you want. I've been doing Nefertiti's nose for 30 years, and that's what I keep doing. So there is an issue about what a surgeon can give you, and does that match what you actually want? Now, sometimes it does, but often it doesn't. And that's when we have problems with cosmetic
surgery.
Okay,
I'm not sure that those images were put together by a surgeon. I know it was a doctor. I don't know if it was a surgeon. But I want to take up the point you made with Andrew and also with you, Angelo. I mean, you must be influenced by notions of beauty. You must be influenced by what you think looks good and by these sort of norms. How much do people get the face that you have in mind, Andrew, as the ideal face, the perfect proportion?
So normally when people come up, I measure. I really do the measurement and longitudinally. So I give more objective suggestion. You know, I can lengthen more, and I expose eyelid a bit more to get more exposure of a pupil size. So that's the way I do operate.
But that notion comes from somewhere originally, doesn't it?
Yeah,
that notion of what an ideal proportion is comes from somewhere.
Yeah, it's golden rule of division.
The golden rule of division is an utterly cultural construct. What we call the golden rule of division now was different 100 years ago. For example, in Victorian times, a receding chin, an almost disappeared chin, was considered very beautiful with women, along with the slight double chin that went with it. So that idea of a kind of universal golden ratio that's existed since ancient Greece, it's a bit of a fallacy.
Okay, I want to show you all something else. Have a look at these two pictures. Okay, Heidi, what do you think of those two?
I'm a bit confused.
What ethnic grouping would you associate them with?
I have no idea. They could be mixed.
Do you find them attractive?
I don't know why, but I keep looking at the girl and she's pretty enough.
Okay, Glenda, you were nodding, saying you find them attractive.
I do.
Do other people find these two attractive?
Yes.
Yes? Generally? Yes? Okay. They're composite pictures of 32 of you. Okay, 16 men and 16 women out of this audience. And there is a theory that if you average out people's features, the composite, there you all are up there, the composite will be more attractive than any individual face. That's the theory. So would you like to look like this?
No. If the surgeons had their way, everybody on the face of the earth would look like that.
Why are you laughing really over confusing. Here, you two?
Oh, we're just trying to see where we are.
You can come and have a look after the show, but I just wonder what people think of that. I mean, do you find that interesting? I find that really interesting. Yeah, that is, you know, 16 men, 16 women out of this audience, that's what you end up with. Yeah.
I've got something I wanted to ask everyone. We've talked about homogenization and hybridization as being attractive and some people moving away from their ethnic cultures, and a lot of people have seen that as a negative thing. So, I mean, we've talked about becoming more westernized, but then we've got western people trying to be darker, people with bigger nose trying to get smaller nose, people with smaller nose trying to get bigger nose. And I'm wondering if maybe we're all going towards some average of everyone. And I find that actually a really beautiful thing when we live in a world with so much racism, that somewhere, maybe psychologically, we find an amalgamation of everyone the most beautiful and everyone's heading towards that. I think that's a beautiful thing.
Okay, we're going to have to wind up, and I think that's quite a good spot to wind up on. But we can keep talking online, so I'd like to invite you all to jump online, and you can keep talking to our guests on our live chat. If you're in the Eastern States, just hop onto our website and click on the link. You can also check out Heidi's video diary in its entirety, Heidi, and you can also keep in touch with us during the week on our Facebook page. Do that as well. Join us again next week. Till then, good night. Join the Inside audience, register by calling 0419 799 137 or just follow the link on our website.